The application of robotics to reverse logistics is the topic of my conversation today with Carl Vause. He is CEO of Soft Robotics. Carl, welcome.
Thank you, Bob. Thanks for having me.
Now, reverse logistics has been referred to as a ticking time bomb for retailers. Is the problem getting worse these days?
It is, and it's really the adoption of e-commerce. And I like to tell the quick story is, when I was a kid, your variety was limited to what was on the shelf at the store. And so you went and you bought, if something was out of stock, you bought a substitute item. Today with Omnichannel, we get what we want when we want. And that's further evolved to, I don't just go try on a pair of jeans at a store and walk out with the one I'm happy. I order four or five, I keep two or three, and the rest go back, because that's what the consumer wants. And so the reverse logistics problem is really driven by consumer choice. And as we go into Omnichannel, more consumer choice, the ability to order, try on, and return things, we've really seen this problem explode in the past few years.
Now that we have succeeded in spoiling the consumer, what will the near future hold? Will it simply get worse, more of the same? What are you looking at in the months and years ahead?
I just don't see a world in which the industry is going to unify and tell the customers no return policies. And so I do think this will continue to worsen. The ticking time bomb, CNBC last year said it was $260 billion problem. This year they're saying it's going to be $310, $350 billion problem. And so it's going to continue to scale. The other problem is the cost of returning an item can be 5 to 10 times more than the cost of originally fulfilling that order. And so it truly is a burden on these companies and the supply chain that has to get solved right now.
So what's at stake for businesses who can't address this problem efficiently?
I think there's one or two things at stake. Either they become non-competitive with punitive return policies, which we've seen some try to do that, and the customer leaves, or we see a significant impact on margins, and you're going to see a real impact on already slim retail margins, and so it has to get fixed.
We haven't even touched on the issue of social media, where a failure in reverse logistics can be broadcast to the world. So the damage that can be done to a company that can't get it right is incalculable these days.
And we've seen one of those, Bob, is right after the Christmas holidays this year, the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation ran an article on a company that was landfilling returns.
Oh my God.
And so you think about that, it's just straight to waste. And I do think that is the damaging type of stories that need to be avoided, so we have to solve this.
Yeah. Enter robotics. How does that address the issue, material handling issue for reverse logistics?
Absolutely, so first in e-commerce robotics, I've always been focused on the order fulfillment, the piece picking, some of the warehouse automation, as you see in the mobile robotics companies. But the problem with reverse logistics is twofold. One is it's immense. It is something that is peaks and valleys. I think we call January 2nd is National Returns Day now in the United States. And so how do companies plan for that? One. Two, right now it's just throw a bunch of people at it. It's flex labor, it's temp labor, it's hard to come by labor. And then three, how do you do it in a way that's consistent? And what's been the barrier there is variation. Is robotics traditionally don't deal with variation very well. As they weld cars very well, they assemble phones very well. We've gotten better at predictable variation, if you will, in the order fulfillment. I know I'm going to be shipping this to Bob, so the robot can be programmed for that. But the problem with returns is you don't know what's coming back and when it's coming back. And so it is the truly unknown problem. And so that's been the barrier to bringing robotics into reverse logistics. And now we're seeing solutions.
Yeah, not just a variation in types of product too, because I imagine that reverse logistics for, say, apparel is quite different than reverse logistics for like a consumer electronics item.
Absolutely.
So are we talking about robotics that can handle whatever is thrown at them, or do they need to be specific to the type of product that they are dealing with?
So our goal at Soft Robotics is a solution that can open any box unknown and solve it. That's our goal. You're right, and if you think about most of e-commerce, the majority of e-commerce packages are in a certain form factor and under 4 pounds. And so that's a more tractable problem. It's still hard, you're still unknowns. But when you get into apparel, we see in the same container returns that could be socks, all the way up to a large winter coat. We've seen luggage, handbags, belts. And so the variation in apparel and the delicate nature of the product it even takes that problem one step farther.
Yeah. Now, with most applications of robotics and material handling and supply chain, there are still people in the mix.
Yes.
So where do people come in? What is their relationship to the robots in the handling of reverse logistics?
Absolutely. And so in the solution we've brought to market is twofold. One is the system still needs to be loaded. And so the system design is these large containers come in, shipping Gaylords or Eurotainers in parts of the world. You don't know what's in them. It could be somewhere between 300 and 400 different items. You open the box and you start literally hands, you pick an item out, you scan it, you put it into a sortation conveyor or a pouch sorter or one of those autonomous storage and retrieval systems. With the system that we have in market today is literally you push that whole container into the cell, you hit run, the robot will tell you when it's done, and then a human has to swap that out. So you can now go from having, you know, tens of people on a line to one person just really making sure that the material is supplied to the robots at the appropriate time.
Uh-huh. I'm trying to picture what this robot looks like. Size, shape, whatever.
Well,
know.
this is a full solution cell that literally does everything from takes the container in, a shipping Gaylord, a Eurotainer. It picks, so it's a robotic, it's machine vision. It picks out of the item. It drops the item onto a singulation conveyor. It then scans the item. If the item scans correctly, because remember you have to match to inventory, because there are times in reverse logistics where one retailer's items end up in the wrong thing and you don't want to put someone else's product into your warehouse. So it says, yep, we know this item, we carry this item, it assigns it to an inventory slot, and this system inducts it. Complete turnkey system that does the robotic picking, the singulation, the scanning, and the return to your automated storage and retrieval system.
And of course, the fate of any particular product coming back in the reverse logistics pipeline, there's several paths that it can take.
Absolutely.
It can go back to a store and go to a DC, it can go to a landfill, it can go to a refurbishing or a repair facility. I take it that the technology allows for all those possibilities now to route them in the right direction?
Well, what we're doing right now is we're really solving that problem in the fulfillment center, which is the key pain point. And so a lot of these returns come through 3PLs that do that initial sort.
And I bet there are people involved there too.
There's a lot of people involved, and we're actively engaged in helping that part of the supply chain out as well. Because it is a full problem from the 3PLs that have to do that initial sort. These things have to be sorted, some have to be rebagged, and so you have people sorting, autofilling, or hand-filling autobagger technology. This technology can do that as well. But really the pain point where we've seen the greatest uptake is in that DC of getting items that we know are good items, are sellable items, but now we have to get them out of that container, singulate them, scan them, and return them into our sellable inventory.
Is there a future for AI being applied to robotics in reverse logistics?
Absolutely. And so I think where we are today, we do use a machine vision in a full software stack, because picking items in polybags, apparel items in polybags, is something robots have never been able to handle before. And so we've used our unique hardware with our machine vision, with our software stack, to bring that to market. Now, we would like to get to a place where you could use AI to identify damaged or undamaged items and bring that process more upstream. But I think where we are today is we've seen significant opportunity in that DC of just when the returnable inventory, the sellable inventory comes back in the building in these large containers, is how efficiently, how quickly can we get that back into sellable inventory? Because it becomes an inventory turn problem. That's the other problem is, in returns, that inventory management isn't just in your center, it's now your full supply chain. Some of it's with your customers. And so sell back, but once again, where can we take it to solve the problems at the 3PLs, at the consolidation facilities as well?
Considering what's at stake, if the system fails in reverse logistics today, it's gratifying to hear that robotics is being brought to bear on the problem, and there are some solutions out there and some improvements are being made. Carl, thank you so much for helping us to understand the nature of this technology and where it's going right now. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Bob, and thanks for having me involved in this very important work you're doing.
I've been speaking with Carl Vause of Soft Robotics. Thank you very much for watching.